Great, thank you so much, Jacob, and good morning, everybody. Let me get my board in place, snazzy new board. Brilliant. As Jacob said, we're in 1 Peter today, which is a letter written by the Apostle Peter, as we learned last week, to Christians scattered all over the world, scattered, not knowing where their home was. And one of the things that Peter says in today's passage is about the importance of staying alert. So let's think about staying alert, shall we? Here's my car, as you can see, here's my steering wheel, and let's go on a little journey, shall we? Okay, here we go.
Oh, I'm so tired. Oh, I can hardly keep my eyes open. Oh, what's that? That's interesting. What's that over there? Oh, look, that's church. That's where I'm going. Oh, that's interesting, isn't it? Oh, red light, better stop. Oh, it's exhausting. I really should have gone to bed earlier last night. Right, come on, right, red light. Oh, we're off. Here we go. Was that blue car there earlier? Was it there earlier? I'm not sure I saw it. I don't think I saw it at all. Well, where's it going? What is it doing? Oh, look at that interesting graffiti wall. Isn't that interesting? What an interesting graffiti wall. Oh, roundabout! There's a roundabout! Oh, where did he come from? Oh, I really must get some proper sleep tonight. Would you get in a car with me? I'm not sure I would. I don't think I'd get in the car with me. You see, I can't keep my eyes on the road ahead if I'm falling asleep, can I? I need to stay alert if I'm going to be able to focus on what's ahead. And that's what Peter says in the first verse of our passage today. Pascaline's going to pop it up. Why don't you join me and we'll read it out loud together. Peter says, "Therefore, with minds that are alert and fully sober, set your hope on the grace to be brought to you when Jesus Christ is revealed at his coming." Peter says we've got to clear our minds, not get distracted, stay alert, and focus on what's ahead when Jesus comes back, our future hope. Do you remember we learned a bit about that last week? Do you remember this verse where Peter wrote about our inheritance we're looking forward to that can never perish, spoil, or fade? Our inheritance that we learned is kept in heaven for us. That's what we're to be looking forward to, looking ahead to. And what we're going to see today is that Peter says that God's people now, that's us, we're very, very much like God's people more than 3,000 years ago. Think back to the Old Testament. Do you remember? For 400 years, God's people were slaves. Slaves in Egypt. Oh, I've got a shiny arrow for that as well. There we go. Slaves in Egypt for 400 years. But God was committed to his people, committed to redeeming them out of slavery. And he did by many amazing signs. Do you remember? Do you remember the plagues, the hail, the frogs, the locusts, the darkness, the death, and the amazing parting of the Red Sea. So the Israelites walked through on dry land while the Egyptian army was completely destroyed. But God didn't just bring them out of Egypt so that they could wander around the wilderness forever and ever and ever. That wouldn't be much of a redemption, would it? No. God promised his people that he'd lead them to, and he'd give them a wonderful promised land. A promised land that they could look forward to and call their own. It would be amazing. You see, the wilderness was not their home. They were to look forward to the land that God had promised them. Do you see how we're a bit like them if we're Christians here today? We look forward to our future hope in heaven when Jesus comes back. And just like the Israelites, we can look back at how God has redeemed us from slavery, not from slavery in Egypt, but slavery to sin. Peter calls it our empty way of life. You see, just like God's people then, this is not our home. We don't belong here. Here's what Peter calls us. He says we're foreigners. But here's the most important thing we're going to see today. Future hope means being different now. Why don't you turn to someone near you or someone next to you and tell them, future hope means being different now. Future hope means being different now. Oh wow, you're much slower than me. Look at somebody else and tell them the same thing. Future hope means being different now. Here's the thing though, we don't like being different, do we? Imagine you're at school and it's a non-uniform day or a mufti day as we call them. But you forget, and you're the only one in school uniform. How do you feel? It's awful, isn't it? I was once invited out for a fancy dinner at a fancy venue. The only thing was, I didn't know it was a fancy dinner at a fancy venue, so I turned up in jeans and t-shirt. Everybody else dressed up, super smart. That was awful, really awful. And it's the same when we're different because we're Christians. Maybe you're the only one you know who reads the Bible with their family. That's different. Maybe you're the only one who can't go to something on a Sunday because you're at church on a Sunday worshipping God. That's different. You're the only one who stands up for what the Bible says about something when everyone else is laughing about it. You're the only one who's not spending their money or their time on certain things because you've got different priorities. Different. Being different makes life hard. We don't like being different. But here's what Peter says. Future hope means being different now. And he doesn't just tell us, he gives us two amazing readings. So as we hear it read, and James is going to come up and read it in just a second. As we hear it read, listen out for these two reasons why it means being different now. The two reasons are a new father and a great price. James.
So the reading is from 1 Peter chapter 1, verses 13 to 21. Therefore, with minds that are alert and fully sober, set your hope on the grace to be brought to you when Jesus Christ is revealed at his coming. As obedient children, do not conform to the evil desires you had when you lived in ignorance. But just as he who called you is holy, so be holy in all you do, for it is written, "Be holy, because I am holy." Since you call on a Father who judges each person's work impartially, live out your time as foreigners here in reverent fear. For you know that it was not with perishable things such as silver or gold that you were redeemed from the empty way of life handed down to you from your ancestors, but with the precious blood of Christ, a lamb without blemish or defect. He was chosen before the creation of the world, but was revealed in these last times for your sake. Through him, you believe in God, who raised him from the dead and glorified him. So your faith and hope are in God.
Amen. Thanks, James, and thanks, Phil. We have the privilege as God's people to hear God's word like we've just heard it, and for the rest of this service, Phil will be unpacking what this passage means to us. But a way to prepare our hearts to hear from God's word is to stand and join in singing in your hearts, telling one another and telling God that as he speaks, we're ready to listen to him. So let's sing in our hearts. God speaks, we listen. Read his Bible, trust, and obey. Let's all stand together, and Pascaline and I will lead you guys in the motions if you'd like to join.
Brilliant. Thanks, Mark and Nathan, and Jacob and Pascaline. Let's try not to trap Nathan in. Oops, sorry. Brilliant. Well, let you tell me about a man. Here's a picture of this man. I actually know this man. And this man, let me tell you a few things about him. Number one, he's very, very tall. Okay, a bit like Mika, I guess you could say. This man on the radio, he listens to classic FM. Also a bit like me. This man, this one's weird. On the 25th of December, quite often, we go to the same building. Isn't that odd? That's very strange. This man often gets told off for whistling and singing and making jokes at inappropriate moments. That's also a little bit like me. Who's this man? Anyone want to tell me? Call it out, who is he? My cousin, my dad. This is my dad, this is my father. He's my father, and here's the thing, we are inevitably, aren't we, influenced by our dads. We inevitably become a bit like them, don't we? And so for Christians, the reason that we're looking forward to our promised inheritance when Jesus comes back is because, as we learned last week, we have been given new birth into a new family. We have a new father. God himself is our father. And since we have a new father, we are to be like him, to be influenced by his character and his ways. Let me read verse 14 to you. Peter writes, "As obedient children, do not conform to the evil desires you had when you lived in ignorance." You see, if we're looking forward to life with God forever, we cannot afford to be drawn back to the life we had before we joined his family. And yet we know the pull, don't we? Every day, to want to live our life in the way that we did before we became Christians. Now, there are echoes here of a story from the Old Testament. Where's my prop gone? Let me have a rummage in here. Here's my prop. Cucumbers, okay? Did you know there are cucumbers in the Bible? They're actually in a couple of places. But the story I want to tell you about is in Numbers chapter 11, okay? And in Numbers chapter 11, God's people, they've been redeemed from slavery in Egypt. They're going to the promised land that God has promised them. But now they're in the wilderness. And in the wilderness, the journey's tough. It's hard going. And very soon they're complaining. This is what they say. They say, "Why did we ever leave Egypt? We were better off in Egypt. We remember the fish we ate in Egypt at no cost. Also the cucumbers, the melons, the leeks, the onions, the garlic." Now, of course, there's nothing wrong with cucumbers. But here's the thing, that people were looking back and saying, wasn't life better back then? Even though they'd been slaves in Egypt and God had promised them a wonderful land. And so for us, we've been redeemed, not from slavery to sin, not from slavery to in Egypt, but slavery to sin. Peter reminds us of the evil desires we had when we lived in ignorance, not knowing God, not knowing his redemption through Jesus, not knowing the promise of our inheritance in heaven. You'd think we'd never want to go back, wouldn't you? But I wonder if you've ever thought, a bit like me, do you know what? I really miss using my money and my time just to get what I want. Instead of serving God and serving others, I really miss being able to use my body in the way that I want without having to consider what God says about it all. I far prefer actually just to be able to lie or push others around unkindly or get angry or hold grudges or join in the gossip or the name calling when it suits me. But Peter says no. We have a new hope given to us by our new Father. We're not to be influenced by our old desires. Instead, we're to be influenced by him, by his character, by what he's like. So what is he like? Let's read verse 15, shall we? Peter says, "But just as he who called you is holy, so be holy in all you do. For it is written, 'Be holy because I am holy.'" Peter's quoting a Bible verse from Leviticus, which is the book of God's instructions to his people while they were in the wilderness. And they'd been redeemed from slavery. They were looking forward to their inheritance in the promised land. And God says to them, "Be holy because I am holy." Now, holy is a really important Bible word. It comes up all over the place. What does it mean, I wonder, for God to be holy? Well, here's what it means. It means he's not like us. He's set apart from us. He's completely different. Let me show you what I mean. One of the amazing things about Israel's time in the wilderness was that God chose to come and live with his people. Wow, that's amazing. And the sign that God lived with his people was this thing, the Ark of the Covenant. It was a great box coated in gold, a great box that said, "Look, God lives with his people." Wow. But the Israelites, they couldn't just go up and touch the Ark of the Covenant. No, God's holy, he's different. He's not like us at all. In fact, the Ark of the Covenant was kept in the tabernacle, and not just in the tabernacle, but in a special part of the tabernacle, a part of the tabernacle called the Most Holy Place. The Most Holy Place. Only the priest could get anywhere near it, and only if they'd been purified and consecrated. And in fact, not all the priests could actually go in to the Most Holy Place. Only one of them could, the high priest. And when he went in, he had to go in wearing the right clothing. Something that looked a little bit like this. Isn't this fantastic? Okay, he had to be wearing this important stuff. And even then, he couldn't just go in whenever he wanted. He could only go in on one day of the year. And when he went in, he had to come in carrying sacrifices for his sin. Because God's holy. He's completely different. He's not like us at all. But here's the wonderful news of the Bible. The Bible says that if we're trusting Jesus, then the most holy God, he's our Father. Isn't that amazing? Our Father who guarantees our inheritance. And so as God's people, as his children, we are to be like him, to be holy, different, set apart for God from those around us. And for the Israelites, that meant different rules around what they could and what they couldn't eat. It meant different ways of doing family life. It meant different ways of worshipping God and not just becoming like all the nations around them. What about for us? Well, have a think. For you as a Christian, how does your life show that you are different from those around you, set apart as a child of your holy heavenly Father? Here are some members of our church family who've recorded a little video with some suggestions.
The Holy Spirit helps you to fight the desires we have that don't please God. That makes you different.
Perhaps you're different because God's love for you makes you generous, even when it costs you. That's what makes you different.
Perhaps you're different because you want to obey your Heavenly Father and do what's right, even when others laugh and wonder why you do it. That makes you different.
Perhaps you're different because you say no to joining in with something, or watching something, or saying something. It might be hard, but it makes you different.
Great, thanks Pascaline. See that? Holiness, being different, set apart, just as our Heavenly Father is holy. You see, our future hope given to us by our Heavenly Father, our future hope means we'll be different now. Well, if I can invite the musicians to jump up. Our next song is about a prayer. It's a prayer to God asking for his help to be different, to be holy. So please do stand and sing along in your hearts. Thanks again, musicians. Do you have a seat, everyone else? Well, and musicians too. Well, imagine what it must have been like. You're an Israelite, one of God's people living in slavery in Egypt. And God has promised he's going to redeem you out of slavery. He's going to take you to the land he promised. But before that can happen, God must show the king of Egypt, the Pharaoh, who the real king is. He's going to come in judgment on Egypt for their sin and for refusing to let his people go. And so you've seen with your own eyes the terrible plagues, the river Nile turning to blood, the locusts, the frogs, the hailstones, the animals dying in the fields, the darkness. And now there's one terrible final plague.
400 years of waiting, there was only one more plague to wait for, the one that would bring freedom to God's people. Moses spoke one final time to Pharaoh. He told him that around midnight, that very night, the Lord would travel through the land of Egypt. Every firstborn son would be struck down and killed, from the firstborn of Pharaoh to the firstborn of the slave. Even in the face of God's wrath, Pharaoh refused. Then the Lord spoke to Moses, saying, "Each man is to take a perfect male lamb for his family and kill it on the 14th day of the month. Then they should take the blood from the lamb and put it on the sides and tops of the door frames of their houses. On that day I will pass through Egypt and strike down every firstborn, both men and animals. But the blood will be a sign for you, for when I see the blood on the door frames, I will pass over you." Moses listened and told the people of Israel what to do. They obeyed, and in his grace God was faithful to his promise to pass over them whenever his angel saw the blood of the lamb. As Pharaoh saw his own son struck dead, he sent for Moses and told him to leave, he and all the people of Israel with all they had. God had kept his promise. His people were free. He led them through the wilderness and gave them commands so they would know how to follow him. In those books of the law, he commanded them to celebrate how God passed over them when he saw the blood of the lamb. This would remind us of his faithfulness as he delivered them from slavery in Egypt. It would also point them forward to the ultimate Lamb of God, Jesus, who would take away their slavery to sin forever.
How was it that God saved his people from judgment and redeemed them from slavery? Well, normally when somebody was a slave, the only way they could be redeemed, the only way they could be set free was for somebody to pay a price. A price, and what would that price be? You'd expect it to be something very valuable. Silver, gold, something very precious indeed, to free a person from slavery. But that was not the price. That was not the price to be paid. No, God told them instead the price was to be one of these, a lamb. And not just any lamb, but a perfect lamb without blemish. Absolutely perfect in every way. And this lamb was to die as a sacrifice. A sacrifice in their place. And so they'd be safe. God, finally, God could redeem his people from slavery in Egypt. And they were to take the blood of the lamb and paint it on the doorpost as a sign. Look, the price has been paid. It's been paid. And they would be safe. But why? Why am I talking about this? I thought we were learning from the book of 1 Peter, aren't we? This happened maybe 1,300 years before Peter wrote his letter, and Peter wrote his letter almost 2,000 years ago. I thought we were learning about our future hope that we have when Jesus comes back. And we need to answer the question of why it had to be a lamb that was the price to redeem the Israelites. Why it wasn't something we consider a bit more precious, more valuable, like silver or gold. Well, here's why. That lamb didn't actually stop God's judgment. It was just a lamb after all. Just a lamb. It couldn't stop God's judgment at all. But the lamb that died as a sacrifice was also a promise. A promise that one day God would send a better lamb, a better sacrifice. Here's what Peter says to the Christians that he's writing his letter to. He says, "For you know, it was not with perishable things such as silver and gold that you were redeemed from the empty way of life handed down to you from your ancestors, but with the precious blood of Jesus, a lamb without blemish or defect." If you're a Christian, this, do you see what a great price God has paid that you could be redeemed from slavery to sin? Jesus, the perfect Lamb of God, the only Son of God, died in your place, just like that lamb. What an incredible price. We think of silver and gold as precious, as valuable, as something that will last forever, don't we? But it won't. They're useless to you when you die. No, to ensure our redemption, to guarantee our inheritance that lasts forever, we need a price that lasts forever. Jesus' blood given for you. What a great price God has paid for us. This was God's plan, Peter says, from before the creation of the world, to send his Son for our redemption. That's how our future hope was won. But do you remember the key thing Peter wants us to learn from today? It's this. Future hope means being different now. Being different. So how does our future hope, bought with the precious blood of Jesus, how does it make us different? Well, here's verse 17. It's a bit surprising. "Since you call on a father who judges each person's work impartially, live out your time as foreigners here in reverent fear." Fear, that's not the word we were expecting, is it? But that's because fear, as Peter uses it, is not fear as we normally use the word. When we talk about fear, we normally mean being afraid of something. So, for example, put your hands up, please, if you're afraid of spiders. Anyone afraid of spiders? A few people are afraid of spiders, okay? Well, I don't really like spiders, but they're okay. Simple glass and piece of paper trick seems to do the trick. But people are afraid of spiders. What about this one? Who's afraid of darkness? Anyone afraid of the dark? Nobody's afraid of the dark here today. What about roller coasters? Who's afraid of roller coasters? A few people there, okay? Or maybe it's not those things you fear. Maybe it's sickness. Or maybe it's a particular person. Or it's loneliness or sadness. We fear things because we don't like what might happen to us. But that's not what Peter means by fear. By fear, Peter means instead a deep sense of awe and respect to our Heavenly Father for the profound, the great price he has paid for us to set us free. You see, if I've been redeemed with the precious blood of Jesus, how can I not be different from everybody else? If I've been redeemed with Jesus' imperishable blood, how can I live my life for perishable things like money and reputation and the things that this life has to offer? If God paid such a great price to rescue me, how can I possibly ignore what he says about how I use my life how I use my body, how I use my money, how I use my time. I can't ignore him. I will be different, even though it is hard to be different. You see, my future hope, which gives me a new father, which was bought at a great price, my future hope means I will be different now. So let's ask for his help, shall we, to be different. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you so much that we have been given new birth into your family, and we can call you our Father. Thank you so much for that great price, the precious blood of Jesus that was paid for our redemption. Thank you so much for our future hope of an inheritance in heaven that can never perish, spoil, or fade. Thank you. Please, we pray, enable us to be different, to be holy, just as you, our Heavenly Father, is holy. In Jesus' name, amen.